Let's work through an example that requires us to calculate displacement and distance traveled given a velocity function. So here are the directions. A hiker travels along a straight trail according to the velocity function v of t equals 3t squared minus 9t plus 6 for t between 0 and 3, where t is in hours and v of t is in miles. And then part A, we're going to graph the velocity function. Part B, we'll calculate the displacement over the time interval from 0 to 3, and then we'll calculate the distance traveled over the time interval from 0 to 3. Okay, so part A says to graph the velocity function on the interval from 0 to 3, and then to interpret the graph in terms of movement of the hiker. Okay, so here I've inserted a graph of our function. So this is a graph of our velocity function. If you remember, it's given by this quadratic, 3t squared minus 9t plus 6. Okay, so here's what we have. So let's just, looking at this graph, kind of talk through what this tells us about the movement of the hiker. So this is a graph of his velocity, okay, not his position, his velocity, so keep that in mind. Okay, so then whenever velocity is positive, that's going to mean the hiker is moving in the positive direction. So you can think of that as like moving forward. Okay, so what happens here? Well, at time equals 0, it looks like the hiker is moving at 6 miles per hour. Okay, so that's pretty fast. So I don't know, maybe he has a lot of energy and the trail's flat, so he starts out running or something like that. But then what happens? Well, our velocity function starts to decrease, but it's still positive, right? So the hiker is still moving forward, but he's going slower and slower. Well, then we get here to t equals 1, and notice that the velocity is 0, so that means the hiker is stopped, right? Just very briefly, right? Just for that one instant in time, he's not moving. And then what happens? Our velocity curve is now below the t-axis, and that means the velocity is negative. Okay, so the hiker is moving in the negative direction, or you can think of that as moving backwards. Okay, so for some reason he's turned around, maybe he dropped something and went back to get it or something like that. Anyway, he's going in the opposite direction, the negative direction. And he continues to go in the negative direction at varying speeds, right, until we get to t equals 2. And once again there, he, for just an instant, is not moving as he changes directions. And then he begins to move in the positive direction again. Okay, and gets going speed-wise faster and faster, but in the positive direction. So this is a way to interpret the velocity graph, right? So the important thing here is to realize when it's positive, he's moving forward. When it's negative, he's moving backwards. When it's 0, he's not moving. Okay, so let's go to the next part of the question. Part B says to find the displacement in miles on the interval from 0 to 3. Well, to do this, we have to remember what displacement means. Okay, so displacement is just the net change in position. So if position function is represented by S and your interval is from A to B, then the displacement would be S of B minus S of A. So your position at some time minus your position at a previous time would give you the displacement over that time interval. Now, the way we find that, if we have a velocity function, is actually the definite integral of that velocity function over the time interval. So displacement then is actually the net area under the velocity curve. Okay, so that's what we're going to be finding here. So if we glance up at our picture, right, we're finding the net area from 0 to 3, right? So we're going to have some positive contribution over here, some negative contribution from when he goes backwards, and then some more positive contribution here. So overall, we expect this to be positive. Okay, net area. So let's go ahead and calculate this. So we're looking at the interval from 0 to 3 of our function. So what I'm going to be calculating is this, the integral from 0 to 3 of 3t squared minus 9t plus 6. Okay, so we can start by taking the antiderivative of this function. Okay, so that's going to give me 3t cubed over 3 minus 9t squared over 2 plus 6t, and I'm going to evaluate that from 0 to 3. Okay, so if I clean this up a little, this is t cubed minus 9 halves t squared plus 6t evaluated from 0 to 3. Okay? So we can go ahead and plug in 3. So if I plug in 3, I get 3 cubed minus 9 halves times 3 squared plus 6 times 3. And then minus this evaluated at 0, but that's just going to give me 0. Okay, so this becomes 27 minus 9 times 9, so 81 over 2 plus 18. And if you work all of that out, you end up with 4.5. And this is in miles, right? Our units are miles. So his displacement is 4.5 miles, right? Which means that net, or overall, he's 4.5 miles away in the positive direction from where he started. Okay, so displacement's not too bad, right? It's just the definite integral of the velocity curve. So let's go into part C. So part C asks us to find the total distance traveled on the interval from 0 to 3. So in part B, we found the displacement, and here we want to find the distance traveled, and these are very different things. Okay, the displacement, sort of like your net change in position. Right, so if you turn around and go backwards, right, you're gonna lose some displacement, right? So if I ran 5 miles, but I started and ended at my house, then my displacement would be 0. Okay, so the displacement is depending on the direction you're going, and it takes that into account. But total distance traveled, I literally just want the total distance traveled, right? So if I'm going in the negative direction, I don't want that to subtract, right? I just want to calculate really what I've traveled. So we're going to have to do this a little bit differently. We're going to have to be a little more clever in the way we approach this. So let's look back at our picture. So I'm still going to think about the area under the curve, but in a little bit of a different way. I'm going to think of the total area under the curve. So if you look at my graph here, I'm looking at the interval from 0 to 3. I can sort of think of this as being divided into three regions, right? So I have this region from 0 to 1. And here I'm going in the positive direction, right? So I've traveled some distance there. Okay, then I stop and I go in the negative direction, but I have this region here. And when I'm calculating the displacement, this little region actually contributes in a negative way because it's below the curve. But now that I'm going to calculate the distance traveled, I don't want that to be negative. I want that to contribute to my total distance traveled, right? Because I am traveling distance there, so I want to include that. And then I have this other region here. So really what I want to do then is I want to calculate the area of each of those regions and add them all in a positive way, right? I want them all to be positive and I want to add them together. So then what we have to do is we have to split up our interval. So then what we're going to do here is you see this is split up at 1 and 2, right? So we have this region from 0 to 1, a region from 1 to 2, and a region from 2 to 3. So I'm going to think about those separately. Okay, so I start with the integral from 0 to 1 of my function. Okay, so that's going to give us the region of that first, or the area of that first region I outlined in blue. And that's already positive, right, because it's above the axis. So no worries there. But this next region is below the axis, but once again, I want to count it as positive since I'm calculating the total distance traveled. So what I can do is I can take the absolute value of it. So I'm going to take the absolute value of the integral from 1 to 2 of my function. And then we have one more region, the region from 2 to 3. And once again, this one's positive, so I don't have to do anything special here. Okay, so now I just need to plug and chug, right? I need to evaluate each of these definite integrals. Now, we've already figured out what the antiderivative of this expression is, right? It is t cubed minus 9 halves t squared plus 6t. That's just from what we did before. Okay, so we're going to have that in each of these situations, but I need to keep track of this absolute value for my middle region. Okay, so that's absolute value sign. Okay, so now I just have to plug in all these values. And for the sake of time, I'm going to spare you the details of all these calculations, right? But for example, for this first integral, I'm going to plug in 1, get a value, plug in 0, get a value, and then subtract those, right? The one where I plugged in 1 minus the one where I plugged in 0. And do that for each of them. So let me just tell you what you get if you do that correctly. So for this first one, you should get 2.5. For this second one, you should get negative 0.5, but it's inside the absolute value, so absolute value of negative half. And then plus another 2.5. So then if I add that all together, I end up with 5.5. So that's, and this is miles, that's his the hiker's total distance traveled, and that sort of makes sense, right? So the displacement was 4.5 miles. That's his net change in position, but he actually traveled 5.5 miles. And that makes sense because he went backwards for a little bit of time. Okay, so this is how you calculate total distance traveled. So the key thing here is that you need to split up your interval based on where the function crosses the t-axis, right? So my zeros were at 1 and 2, so I split up the interval based on those points. And really in this case, having a graph is one of the most helpful things, so you can see where you need to split things up. All right, so hopefully this gives you a good sense of how to calculate displacement and how to calculate total distance traveled.